Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you share it with a friend. This morning, Pastor John begins a new series entitled, Operating in the Spirit Realm. We live in a physical world and most people never think about the existence of a spiritual dimension. Many just dismiss it as fantasy because of the plethora of movies and books on the subject. But the reality is that God and His holy angels live in the spiritual realm, as do Satan and his fallen angels. Furthermore, nothing happens in the physical realm unless it has been sanctioned by God. The birth of Jesus was one such event where the Son of God and holy angels crossed over into our physical dimension. This did not go unnoticed by Satan and his demonic forces, and they too came into our physical world, slugging it out on earth and using mankind as an intermediary. This huge spiritual conflict played out in the land of Israel, and the modern church has failed to teach Christians that we can and should operate in the spiritual dimension. This message is entitled, Supernatural Intervention. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Praise the Lord, and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church Worldwide on February the 9th, 2014. And I'm glad to have you here, and today I'm going to preach a very short sermon. And normally I have 4 to 5 pages, and I got 1 page. And I asked myself, how can I make this last? But we're going to stay on this because it's a new series, Operating in the Spirit Realm. Let me explain this series to you. We are living in the physical world, but we need to break into the spirit world. We are not going to do that by the power of Satan or by demons. But you see, when we are born again, we have a spirit that is born. We had a dead spirit before. The spirit that is in us, with our soul and our body, but the spirit soul man now, which is really you, now you have access to God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, through the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is enabling us to break into the spirit world. Just a few moments ago here today, we had a testimony of this couple from Alaska. And they had been in bondage for a number of years, had demons in their bodies, like I would say 99% of most people have today, because of the way we have lived the last 50 years. And there was no way you could shoot these demons out. You could not cook them out. You could not sit in a sauna for 10 hours and sweat them out. It's impossible to get demons out. They got to come out. You got to enter the spirit world and attack them in the spirit world and knock them out. How do we do that? Through the power of the Holy Spirit. When people need to be healed, the sickness, we can have accident, but most sicknesses are caused by emotions, demonic powers that simply break our bodies down. Now, God has told us we have 120 years. It's just like you buy a car. They give you a warranty, 60,000 miles or 3 years, whatever comes first. We got a fantastic guarantee in the Bible. 120 years, maintenance free, if you obey the word of God and live according to his physical laws, which none of us have done. We ate the junk food. We didn't take care of our bodies. They begin to break down. And then we cry out, oh, God, heal me. And God says, I will. But I also want you to change your lifestyle. So we need to learn how to break in. And today I'm going to lay a foundation how God supernaturally moved from the spirit world into the physical world and did an intervention. Let me have you take your Bibles and turn with me to the Gospel of Luke chapter 1. That's the Gospel of Luke and the very first chapter. And we're going to read it from verse 11 when I get to, but let me give you a little introduction first. Luke 1:11, that's where we're going to start. In my outline, which you can have downloaded here on the internet, I simply said I talk about the power of gravity. Now, I want you to think about the universe. The reason I can stand upright here, the reason that this pulpit is not floating around, and the reason that people sitting in here are not in the air someplace where we have to pull them down, is because of the power of gravity. Now, I cannot feel the power of gravity. I cannot grab it. I cannot see it. But it is a force. And if you really pressure a scientist and say, can you define what is gravity? They cannot really define it. They say it's a power. It's energy. It has drawing power. But what it is, they do not know. We just know it is there. In Hebrews, matter of fact, this is a bonus scripture here. In the book of Hebrews, chapter 1, God tells us what gravity is. And we pick it up here from Hebrews chapter 1, verse number 1. God, who at sundry times and in divers manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, has in his last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom is appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. Let me slow down, I'll read too fast. Who bring the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. The Bible says here, Jesus, with his word, upholds all things. Now, I remember going back to my college days, late 50s, early 60s, and I had to take some chemistry. And we were looking at the atomic world. And I was told, we saw hydrogen has one proton, one electron. The proton is positive, the electron is negative. Then they said, now we take oxygen. Oxygen is two protons, two electrons together, and each proton is positive. I was thinking then, but I never got an answer. Now, I had played with magnets. If you take a magnet here and a magnet there, you take the same polar, so to say, and put them together, they repel each other. If you turn them around, they attract each other. And I asked, I said, now, what is it that holds these protons together that are both positive together and they are not expelling one another? They couldn't tell me. So far, I don't believe that any scientist have been able to tell that. But I can tell you who does it. It's a power of the word of the Lord Jesus Christ. An enormous energy, a flood of energy that just is surging into the universe and holding everything together as it sits there and shakes. Let's talk about the moon right now. The moon moves around the earth. Why doesn't the moon take off? Because there's gravity. The moon is held in its position by the gravity of the earth. What is ebb and flow in the oceans? You ever wonder, you know, why we have this and that, but the moon is at a certain place? It's a gravity from the moon that simply has an impact on the water and pulls the water up and then let us down again. Now, the moon and the earth, we are spinning around the sun. Tremendous speed. What holds us? Why don't we just take off? We got other planets. Why is all the planets in an orderly and they go like this around and around and they never deviate? Why? Gravity. Gravity is a power that God is using to hold all things in place. Gravity is energy coming from God. Gravity is a spiritual power manifesting in the physical world. Now, when the Holy Ghost came down upon Jesus, we had supernatural power now coming into him. And through him, he began to heal the sick, cast out demons, walked on water, raised the dead, did all kinds of different things. And then he told the disciples, I'm going to send you out and you're going to do the same thing. Now, centuries later, 2,000 years later, very few people really believe this because all we have seen in our lives is unbelief. I want to talk about two birds. We got turkeys and we got eagles. Now, turkeys, they made them domestic. We tamed them. We fed them. We tweaked them. A turkey doesn't fly. He doesn't soar. When was the last time you saw a turkey fly around soaring in the air? You don't. They walk on the surface of the earth. They might flap their wings a little bit. There's some wild turkeys that can fly, but domestic turkeys do not fly. Then you got the eagles. The eagles love to fly. They enjoy it. They soar. They move up in the high up in the air. And they used to have a good time flying on the winds effortless. The Bible says he has renewed our youth, our days like the eagles. The Bible refers to us as eagles. But you know what? Most Christians are turkeys, fat turkeys, walking around looking for a handout, squawking, gobbling, and simply saying, you know, I need some more cool water, I need some more grain, you know, I want to get a little bit more fatter. And then you have eagles that have been told you're turkeys, you can't fly anymore. And here we have eagles walking around in a turkey farm. And they simply says, you know, I guess this is life now. Until somebody says, use your wings. And the turkey gets him out. He says, well, maybe I'll try. And he tries. And suddenly he's airborne. He says, I'm not a turkey. I'm an eagle. The Holy Spirit wants you to move in and out of the spirit world and do damage to the kingdom of Satan. Let's talk about the birth of Jesus Christ now. It is sad when we had the Christmas story. You know, they basically have a little story about how he was born. But there's much more to it. There was a supernatural event. And this is God. God simply said, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit said this. They said it before the foundation of the world. We're going to intervene in the physical world. We're going to cross over. And to do that, he crossed over with power and with the holy angels. Angels play a vital role in the kingdom of God. You and I cannot tell angels what to do. They don't take orders from us. We have to talk to our Heavenly Father, and he tells the angels what to do. But you see, we can lose angels. We can ask God to send angels to do things because he wants to use his angels. I remember what I said in the beginning. I didn't say that on this message, but simply this. If you want God to move in the affairs of men, you have to simply ask him, and he will interfere. Let's read now in Luke chapter 1 and verse number 11. So God started now. He simply needed a forerunner, Elijah. If you read Malachi prophesied, a light that will come and restore things. And there appeared unto him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. This was not Zechariah the priest. And when Zechariah saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. Remember now, Zechariah was a turkey. He was working in the temple. They sacrificed, but they never heard from God. They never saw any miracles. They simply were turkeys doing their rituals. And that's the way God wanted to do the rituals, but nothing wrong with that. But simply this, he did not expect anything supernatural. But the angel said to him, "Fear not, Zechariah, for your prayer is heard, and your wife Elizabeth shall bear you a son, and you shall call his name John. And you shall have joy and gladness, and many shall rejoice at his birth. For he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, shall drink neither wine nor strong drink, and he shall be filled with the Holy Ghost, even from his mother's womb. And many of the children of Israel shall return to the Lord their God. And he shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Now, that's a nice presentation. How would you like an angel come into you and says, "Look, I just want to inform you that God has called you for some great work." And you says, "Okay, that's nice. We're going to give you some power. We're going to do all kind of things with you." "Really? But I'm a turkey." We need to expand our minds and recognize you are an eagle, not a turkey. And Zechariah said unto the angel, "Whereby shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife well stricken in years." If you want to make God angry, doubt him. If you want to make God upset, read the scripture and says, "Well, God, I don't know about this." You got his attention there, but not the attention you want. And he will simply say, you know, unbelief, I can't stand it. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. We have to come to him by faith. And he can only be pleased if you come by faith. Zechariah now didn't say a whole lot, but he simply said, "Look, Mr. Angel, I'm an old man. My wife does not have menstruation periods anymore. She's simply, you know, not having any childbearing capacity. And you are telling me that we're going to have a child?" That's really what he told the angel. Now, the angel got upset. He got perturbed. You see, angels also get upset. If you go back in the book of Exodus, I don't have time right now. God warned Moses and the people. He said, "Now, my angels shall go before you. Don't irritate him. Don't provoke him, because he doesn't bear the sword in vain." And Moses got scared to death. And he said, "Lord, unless you go with me, I'm not going to go just for an angel. I'm not going to go unless you go. I need a daddy to hold my hand." But we need to learn to have respect for God's holy angels. Listen to what the angel said now. And the angel answers unto him, "I am Gabriel, that stand in the presence of God." He gave his credentials now. He was not a low-ranking angel. He was a high-ranking angel standing next to the throne of God. That's his position. He said, "Do you know who I am? I'm Gabriel, that stand next to God." "And I am sent to speak unto you and to show you these glad tidings. And behold, you shall be dumb, and not able to speak until the day that these things shall be performed, because you believe not my words, which shall be fulfilled in their seasons. And the people waited for Zechariah and marveled that he tarried so long in the temple. And when he came out, he could not speak unto them. And they perceived they had seen a vision in the temple, for he beckoned unto them and remained speechless. They gathered the son, they named him John. What can we learn of this? God continued the plan with Zechariah and Elizabeth. He didn't change that. But you see, instead of Zechariah being able to come out of the temple and saying, praise the Lord, guess what? I saw an angel. I'm going to be your daddy. He couldn't talk. So do not have unbelief. Change your vocabulary. Change your thinking. Through Christ, I can do all things. Through Christ, I can do all things. Let's talk a moment here about Lazarus. Now, Lazarus was a good personal friend of Jesus. Martha and Mary, good friends. He often stayed in their home. Word was sent to him, Lazarus is sick. Jesus didn't go. Jesus waited 3 days. 3 days, Lazarus dead. Lazarus, they put him in the cave, rolled a stone there. But you've been dead for 3 days. You swell up. Your cells begin to break down. Your eyeballs are shot. Nerves are shot. Your brain is mush. You are meatloaf, if I can use that term. Now, Jesus came to raise up Lazarus. I believe that Jesus simply, he could have got rushed down and said, okay, Lazarus, be healed. And he was healed just like this. What had he learned all that? Nothing. So Jesus waited. And when he came down, Martha came up and said, you know, Jesus, if you would have been here, he wouldn't be dead. Your fault, Jesus. Jesus said, show me where he is. Martha said, he already stinks. He's gone beyond what you can do. Jesus said, show him where he lives, where he is. Then Jesus stood in front of that. There's a lot of tombs there. And the reason that Jesus said, you know, come out, Lazarus, if he would have said, come on out, he would have got 500 people coming out of their graves. But he specified, Lazarus, come forth. What happened to the body of Lazarus? In a nanosecond, if you know what that means, that's a very small fraction of time. The resurrection power of God came down upon that body. And in no time at all, every cell was restored. His soul and spirit was put back in. Blood began to flow and pumping. And he was like brand new. And he come on out, walk. He was bound up. And Jesus said, loose him and let him go. Can you imagine? I like Jim Miller. He had a song that he sings about Lazarus and come out. Can you imagine Lazarus walking around in the city later on? And people say, you know, I thought you were dead. Yeah, I was dead, all right. But Jesus raised me up from the dead. What are you doing here, Lazarus? You're dead. No, I'm not dead anymore. I was dead. You see, our brain, our capacity, our faith capacity is so small. We look upon a disease as a mountain. We see this mountain, that mountain. 3 years ago, my wife and I we've gone through a tremendous period of trials. 3 years ago, I didn't see a way out. I could not see physically in my mind a way out. I couldn't see that. But I decided to do one thing. I've been preaching for many years. My wife's been praying. We've been doing things. You've been singing. I simply said, we're going to slug this out. We didn't get victory in one day. We didn't get victory in 1 year. We didn't get victory in 2 years. It took us 3 years. But what we did was we slugged it out. And we simply said, we are not turkeys, we are eagles. And we are not going to be defeated. And Satan has rolled out everything he had to throw against us, including breaking up and destroying the ministry we had and everything else. But he failed because we made a decision. We're going to stand and believe that God is able. Turn to now verse 26. Verse 26. In the same chapter. We read the following. And in the 6th month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God into a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin exposed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, you that are highly favored, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women. She was a teenage girl, anywhere from 13, 14 years old, maybe up to 15 or 16. Just a young girl, teenage girl. Angel come in. Now, she'd been a turkey all her life. She had never seen anything supernatural. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and cast in her mind what manner of salutation it should be. And the angel said to her, Fear not, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you shall conceive in your womb, bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord of God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. He shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Then said Mary unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I know no man? She didn't say, Now this is impossible. She was curious. She said, Okay, that's fine. Okay, how are you going to do this? And the angel answered and said to her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon you, and the power of the highest shall overshadow you. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of you shall be called the Son of God. And behold, your cousin Elizabeth, she has conceived a son in her old age, and this is the 6th month with her, who was called barren. Now look at verse 17. For with God, nothing shall be impossible. If there's nothing you take with me today from this message or this service, take this with you. For with God, nothing shall be impossible. For with God, nothing shall be impossible. Take that with you. Now Mary simply accepted it, as she said in verse 38, Behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to your word. And the angel departed from her. You might say, now what did she face? Would you say in the days, and I just give you quickly, I thought I had a short sermon here today. The time of Jesus, marriages were arranged. And Mary and Joseph as children. Their parents had met. They had made an agreement. They signed an agreement. They paid so much money to Mary's parents for her as a woman. And they were engaged, betrothed from childhood, maybe 3 or 4 years old. It was recorded at the courthouse. The children were taken back to their families. And they were raising them. And then when a man had enough, he could make a living, he would take his wife, they would have a wedding feast, he would consummate the marriage, and that's how marriage was done in those days. The law in Israel was this. If a woman was espoused or engaged and she got pregnant by somebody else, there was a death sentence. Stone them to death immediately. Here's Mary now saying, okay, great, I'm pregnant. I'm not married yet. How do I explain that to Joseph? How do I explain that to my family when they see me beginning to get bigger? And God spoke to Joseph, we're not going to read it right now, an angel, through a dream, and said, take your wife. The child in there is from me. And Joseph took her and protected her, so no one knew that Joseph and her had not come together. So she had a child, Jesus. Now, let's look upon Luke chapter 2. That's the Gospel of Luke chapter 2. If you pick it up here in verse number 8. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them. The glory of the Lord shone around about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said to them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of a heavenly host, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let not go even to Bethlehem, and see the thing which has come to pass, which the Lord has made known unto us. God simply said this, I'm going to make an impact. And he sent in thousands of angels that appeared before these shepherds. And they realized, God is moving. We are no longer turkeys. The Messiah is coming. Finally, the Messiah is coming. So the birth of Jesus Christ was a supernatural intervention of God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, and His holy angels into the physical world. The angels are still with us today. And all they are waiting for is for us to pray so that they can get some orders to go out and do some destruction in Satan's kingdom. Now turn to Matthew chapter 2 here. Matthew chapter 2. You got to look at slugging 2. You know, I hate the devil. He's like a pit bull. He never gives up. I want to paint the picture for you. We used to live in the Sacramento area in a subdivision. And we had a redwood fence, kind of a little flimsy, but he had holes and stuff in it. And the neighbor had a pit bull. He was a vicious pit bull. He was so bad that he even bit his own children. And so this pit bull could jump. I seen him jump over a 4-foot fence. The fence between us was about 6 feet. So I hoped he couldn't jump 6 feet. And whenever we went out in the yard, he would be there snarling and barking and just tearing on, and he would chew on the fence. I could see the fence just shaking. So I got spray bottles. I got you the stuff you spray for ants and stuff like that to kill them, you know. I got a hole, and that dog was there, you know, and I sprayed him in the mouth. I took a water hose and I filled him with water. I did everything I could. He just kept coming. He will not give up. That's how the devil is. You knock him down, he comes back up. He comes back one way or this way or that way. Every day you got to fight him by simply saying in the name of Jesus, we're not going to have any defeats today. So what did the devil do? I want you to catch this now. This is important. Satan could not move as a spirit and kill Jesus. Demons could not go as spirits and kill Jesus. Satan needed a body. The demons need bodies. When you see the mass killings that we have seen the last year or so, and these people are doing them, and they look with glazed eyes and so on. These were satanic killings. These were people that had been groomed or whatever Satan had done to them and people have done to them. Mass killers. So remember this. When a demon shows up, he cannot touch you unless you have fear. So Satan needed a human being. And we read quickly here that now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, where is he that is born, king of the Jews? We have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him. When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. Herod was not a reader of the Bible. He was a dirty politician. But when he needed some information, he got very religious. And they said unto him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, and thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of you shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel. Then Herod, when he had privately called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search diligently for the young child, and when you have found him, bring me word again, that I may come and worship him also. He was a liar. He was a crook. He wasn't going to worship. He was going to kill that baby. You got to remember this now. You're called of God. God has called you to the ministry. God has called you to do things. And when he says called to the ministry, that doesn't mean that you're going to be preaching, evangelist, missionary, full-time, going someplace. Every person is called into the ministry. Your mission field is where you live, where you work. Some of us are called to be full-time, but everyone is called to the ministry. Do you think that Satan is saying, well, look at that. Someone just got a revival, got filled with the Holy Ghost. Wow. He's going to say, look at that person filled with the Holy Ghost. Call out the fire department. I want cold water on that person. I want defeat, gloom, doom, sickness. Do what you can, but take him out. That's how the devil operates. So remember this. The moment you get closer to Christ, you are a target. That comes with the territory. A lot of Christians says, well, you know, if I don't talk about the devil, if I don't do anything, he leaves me alone. Yeah, for a while. And when you come to heaven, they're going to ask, what did you do for me? I was hiding around, avoiding the devil. We are to confront him, to move him down. Verse 9, when they heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them, till he came and stood over where the young child was. When he saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, and his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented to him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned of God in a dream, that they should not return to Herod, they departed into their own country another way. God intervened. He had seen Satan move on Herod, And God simply said, we're going to deflect that. He told the wise men, go in a different direction. And when they were departed, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, arise and take the young child and his mother and flee into Egypt, and be you there until I bring you word, for Herod would seek the young child to destroy him. God knows in advance the plans of the enemy. There are people cursing me every day. There are people cursing this ministry every day. There are people in witchcraft, in all kind of different Satanists, who knows where they are. And they simply saying, we got to take that John Torell out before he ignites some more people. We got to cool him down. You got to learn to fight. God warned me and Ina. I had a warning. I saw what happened to another minister. And I simply said, I am not going to repeat his mistake. And we have stood and are still standing. And we stand tomorrow. I'm claiming 120. And when God said to give you 120, he didn't say that the last 40 years be in a wheelchair. He said you can have 120 and be just like Moses. When Moses was going to go home, it says his life power was not abated. He still had full force. His eyes were not dim. And guess what? Moses was processed on a mountain. That's where God took him. That was his funeral home. There was not anyone carrying him up the mountain. He walked up the mountain. He walked up the mountain, his own funeral. Then God said, fine, Moses, let me take you out of your body. I'm going to bury you, because if I let them bury you, they make a shrine of you, and they go and pray to you for the rest of the life on earth. So no one knew where they put him. God is so smart. Now Herod, and he was there unto the death of Herod, that he might be fulfilled that was spoken of the Lord by the prophesying out of Egypt, have called my son. Then Herod, when he saw that he was mocked of the wise men, was exceeding wroth, and sent forth and slew all the children that were in Bethlehem, and in all the coast thereof, from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had diligently inquired of the wise. There was fulfilled that was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet, saying, in Ramah there was a voice heard, lamentation and weeping and great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children, and would not be comforted because they are not. Herod was filled with Satan. And Satan simply told Herod this. Hear me now. Satan told Herod this. In order to make sure we get this baby boy, you kill them all. 2 years and under. No mercy. So much for a benign ruler. Supposed to rule the people and be for the people, of the people. Did Herod go down and kill them? No. He sent his soldiers. And these soldiers were demon-possessed. Let me just say this. As you come down into the Antichrist system, there's going to be Americans that are working for the Homeland Security, the CIA, the FBI, all kind of different organizations. And for a paycheck, for pension, they will turn on us, the rest of us. They will be possessed by demons. They will be evil. Remember this, Adolf Hitler didn't kill, he only killed one person himself. And that was Röhm, the guy for the SA. He shot him himself. But Hitler didn't kill anyone. The men and the women that killed the people in Nazi Germany were teachers, engineers, pastors. farmers, general, normal people, they were transformed into servants of Satan. How do we combat these people? Through the Holy Ghost. So we now got to come to the place that we recognize that we cannot walk in the physical world and fight with physical weapons. We can have physical weapons, nothing wrong with them. But that's just a resort we have. Maybe give us security. But you see, with the power of the Holy Ghost, we can do a lot of damage. I urge you to go back. I might be speaking on it later on, another sermon. Two or three of the battles in Israel. God told the Israelites, you're not going to fight. I'm going to do this. And how did he do it? He sent his angels in. They simply made every enemy soldier mentally ill. Confusion. And they turned their swords on one another. And the enemy killed himself. Look upon Elijah. He was sitting up on a rock. 50 soldiers came and the captain. And Elijah said, if I be a man of God, let fire fall on these here. And fire fell and they killed him. He didn't lift a finger. Just like this. We got to learn not to move into the supernatural. If you come to a place with something in the name of Jesus, drop dead. Be gone. We got to begin to move as the Holy Spirit leaves us. Some of you might say, well, should we pray for our salvation first? Listen, once they have taken the mark of the beast, they cannot be saved. This changed the equation completely. When you and I would encounter people that had the mark of the beast, they're gone, cannot be saved. We have the right to take them out. Because God has simply said they cannot be saved. Let me wrap this up. Turn to Matthew 26. Some of you might got scared and I says, well, I don't know about this. Matthew 26. Then said Jesus to him, put again your sword into his place. For all that they take the sword shall perish with the sword. Don't you think that I can now pray to my Father, and he shall presently give me more than 12 legions of angels, 72,000 angels. God committed to this battle of sending in Jesus to be born, 7 legions of angels. And these angels simply control the spirit world. Because Zechariah, Mary, Joseph did not know how to do spiritual warfare. It had to be done for them. Today, it's a different matter. Jesus has defeated Satan at the cross. He is defeated. Jesus has all the power in heaven and on earth, and we have been commissioned to simply fight the enemy. Let me read my summary here. The incarnation of Jesus, the human body, became a flashpoint in the spirit world as both God and the devil dispatched large number of combat forces to Judea. Most of the people present in Judea at the time had no clue of the gigantic battle that took place in the spirit world. Jesus told us that God had committed 12 legions of angels with 72,000. I changed my number up to 72,000 angels. Where are these angels today? They're still on earth. They're more than that. Right now, this is a flashpoint. My message now has been going out on the internet, reaching where you are. Later on, it will be on YouTube on the video, Vimeo. And for the next years or so, for a number of years, this message will be played over and over again. And every time it is played over, the power of God will be released. This is a battle place. Right now, God is calling his people and saying this, are you willing to be an eagle in the last days? Not to be a turkey, but to be an eagle and to do something. So when you leave this earth, it will be said of you, that man, that woman knew God. They walked with God. They did great things with God's help. And they changed many lives. Or do you want to leave the world saying, this guy was a great golfer. He was a great this or that. And you leave empty-handed. Supernatural intervention. How do we close a message like this? Well, I'm going to have to give you more information as I begin to bring out sermon after sermon. But maybe today, two things. For with God, nothing is impossible. Secondly, get off the turkey farm and start flying with the eagles. We're going to stand, we're going to pray, and I'm going to ask Thomas here to come and lead us in a closing prayer. And after you had prayed, we're going to have Charles Torell come, and he will tell those of you that are not saved how to be saved. So do not turn off your computer, stay with it, and Charles will come as soon as Thomas is finished.
Father God, thank you for the word, Lord. Thank you for leaving us here on the earth with all the tools that we need, Lord. And we know that it is not an easy road, Lord, but everything is there for us. Help us, Lord, to apply these principles in our lives, to walk by faith. Thank you for spiritual guidance. Keep us soaring with the eagles, Lord. We just thank you for our many blessings, Lord, but thank you for the Word of God that is our guidebook on the earth. And we thank you for this day. We thank you for the rain that we have in the last few days, Lord, critical for California. And as I was down in the Central Valley a few weeks ago, I saw a huge infrastructure for farming. And without water, there will be no farming. So I thank you, Father God, for mercy. We know that the world government desire is first to control the mind, and second, to control the water supply, which also controls the food supply. So we thank you, Father God, that people will take control of their own mind, that they will relinquish their mind to you, and then we will be able to defeat the works of the enemy. And we thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you'll die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, You've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person. Doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you 3 questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all 3 questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these 3 questions are but 3 of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are 3 places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of 2 places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, You need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now, and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever.
Listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the first part in the series, Operating in the Spirit Realm, and was entitled Supernatural Intervention. God and His holy angels live in the spiritual realm, as do Satan and his fallen angels. When it comes to the physical world, nothing happens unless it has been sanctioned by God. The birth of Jesus was a supernatural event when the Son of God with holy angels crossed over into our physical dimension. This intervention did not go unnoticed by Satan and his demonic forces, and they too crossed over, slugging it out on earth and using mankind as an intermediary. The problem for the people involved 2,000 years ago was that they did not have full knowledge of the spiritual conflict that was being played out in the land of Israel. But the modern church is ignorant of the matter as well. God wants us to be active in the spirit world through the power of the Holy Spirit to counter the works of the devil. The spirit realm is not a fantasy. It is just as real as our physical world, and God wants us to operate in both dimensions. This message is available on cassette, CD, and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1430. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can learn more about Pastor Torell's ministry, read insightful articles, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.